Malbork. A common heritage.
Witam Was serdecznie w Malborku i chciałam kilka słów opowiedzieć o zamku Malbork. Zamek Malborku wybudowali Krzyżacy. Wybudowali go w takim stanie, jaki teraz widzicie. Wybudowali tu aż 3 zamki.
Und jetzt eine kurze Geschichte. Was war der Deutsche Orden? Pflege der Schutzorden in der Kreuzige sollte schützen diesen Gebiete, wo das Grab Christi war. Erste Hauptsitz des Ordens war in Akko bei Palästina.
Polish and German tourists in the castle of Malbork. They are the major part of 500,000 visitors seeing the building every year. To them, Malbork is not only the largest castle of brick in Europe, but also a symbolic place well known from their school books. Its history reminds of the conflicts that separated our countries. Meanwhile, the castle has been entered on the list of the World Heritage of Culture. Well, can the story of Malbork be the same in both languages today? Let us begin the story of Malbork in the Castle Museum. For this is where the exhibits reminding of Prussians, the earliest inhabitants of the lands, are gathered. They inhabited the Baltic coast between the Vistula and the Neman. They made a living mostly of farming and hunting. Being organized in tribal and family unions, they did not create their own state. And yet, they were aggressive neighbors and pagans. Therefore, at the beginning of the 13th century, the Polish Duke Conrad of Mazovia invited the Knights of the Order of St. Mary the Virgin, formed in the Teutonic House in Jerusalem. Within some 50 years, the Knights of the Cross completed the conquest of the Prussian lands and set up their independent state, administered from a network of castles, fortresses. In the 80s of the 13th century, on the river Nogat, the Teutonic Order started building a complex called Mary's Castle, Marienburg. Within about 30 years, a castle closed in a quadrangle was raised, as well as the castle approaches adjacent to it. In accordance with the needs of the Brethren Knights, within the fortifications there were, among others, a chapel, a dining room called a refectory, a bedroom called a dormitory, a chapter house where debates were held, and a room for ill people called an infirmary. The whole castle was enclosed with a defensive wall, with corner turrets, and surrounded with a moat. A characteristic element of the fortifications was a tower called Gdanisko, which was connected with the castle by a gallery coming out of the southwestern corner. And this is what the imposing block called the High Castle looks like at present. Buildings, defensive walls, turrets. They were all made of brick. The severe walls are ornamented only with friezes and patterns arranged of overburnt brick. Merely the foundation walls and some details were made of stone. The steep high roofs were covered with tiles. We can imagine how impregnable the huge block of the castle must have seemed to the order enemies. Today, however, having crossed the wooden bridge over the moat, we can visit the castle. To the courtyard leads the entrance surmounted by a stone portal. It is an original monument from before 700 years. This information is important, as most of what we're going to see is the later work of conservators. In the middle of the courtyard, there was a well. Independent water supply was essential to survive a siege, and in peaceful times made life easier. Even from the courtyard, you can enter several rooms, but let us first see the most important halls of the higher stories. Here is the interior of the refectory. Today it is empty, and its best decoration is the seven slender pillars supporting the vaults. There was a time, however, when long tables stood in here, at which, after grace, in conformity with the religious regulations, the lay brethren used to have meals. And these massive granite pillars support the dormitory vaults. This is where, together, on very simple beds, in their clothes and with light on for the whole night, the lay brethren used to sleep. The chapter house, where councils were held, chaired by the commander of the order. The ribbed vault is supported by three pillars only, which makes the room look monumental and dignified. On the walls, there are pictures of the Grand Masters and paintings referring to the vows of poverty, chastity and obedience, which were obligatory to the monastic knights. The ornamented tile floors are an important element of the interior decorations of this room. On the floors, we can also see the lids for closing the ducts conveying warm air. This is a medieval, but how very modern heating system that was applied in Malbork. Finally, the chapel, so important in the whole complex. The Golden Gate leads inwards, one of the most famous monuments of Malbork. The temple is a symbol of heaven, so the gates symbolize the entrance to the world of the just. That is why it was used to instruct the illiterate brethren knights and remind them of the last judgment they were in for. It is the portal bas-relief that tells the story of the Last Judgment. On the left-hand side, the procession of five wise maidens with lamps burning with love. The maidens are smiling, as they will gain the grace of redemption. On the other side, five unwise maidens. They have abandoned God and will be rejected. Synagogue, who is leading them, is blindfold, which is to show how wrong she has gone. On the portal, there are also pictures of animals, goats, dragons, mermaids, wild boar, centaurs are the medieval symbols of Satan, heresy and sins. In order to get to the next famous monument in the High Castle, we must pass along a gallery. The gallery. This is Granisko, which was a defensive tower and a toilet. It was probably in Malbork where such a structure was built for the first time. Naturally, due housekeeping facilities were to be found in the High Castle as well. Therefore, we are still going to see the kitchen. The arrangement of this interior carries us back to a little later times when the castle in Malbork became the capital of the whole state of the Teutonic Order. In the courtyard of Malbork Castle, there are four sculptures representing the Grand Masters of the Order. They include Siegfried von Feuchtwangen. It was under his rule when, after the conquest of Gdańsk Pomerania, the capital of the Teutonic state was transferred from Venice to Malbork in September 1309. The transfer of the Grand Master's seat to Malbork started a new stage in the enlargement of the castle. The High Castle was extended. In the place where the castle approaches had been located, the middle castle was raised and new castle approaches were built from the northern side. The complex enclosed in the walls covered the area of over 20 hectares. In the High Castle, an eastern wing and cloisters round the courtyard were built, the chapel was enlarged and a tower was erected. The middle castle was formed by the buildings on three sides of the courtyard, where a special setting was given to the palace of the Grand Masters jutting towards the river. The new castle approaches were filled with homesteads. The entire complex had been built by the middle of the 14th century. It was the time of the greatest splendor of both the Order and Malbork. Let us now see more closely what the castle looked like after the capital of the Order had been transferred here. The High Castle remained the seat of the convent, but it had to undergo reconstruction. Thus, some functional alterations were made and a more splendid architectural setting was created. Presentable cloisters were added round the courtyard. Upstairs, they gained a very decorative form. From one side, the cloisters were open to the courtyard. From the other, there were entrances to particular rooms. What underwent a thorough extension was the castle chapel, which became the most important temple of the Teutonic Order. On demolishing the eastern gable, a polygonal presbytery was added, which lengthened the chapel by nearly 20 meters. Unfortunately, the chapel is waiting to be restored after the war damage, and that is why some elements of its interior decorations are to be found in the Castle Museum. Here are the beautiful figures of apostles which decorated the walls of the chapel. The 8 meters long statue of Madonna with the infant, which had been standing in the internal bay of the presbytery, was also destroyed during the war. The extension of the church beyond the High Castle resulted in building a new room, St. Anne's Chapel. Here, the Grand Masters were buried. Both entrances to the chapel are embellished with imposing portals. In In the northern portal, the scenes devoted to the cult of the Virgin Mary draw special attention. While the southern portal contains scenes from Christ's life. Below are four figures of apostles. In the chapel interior itself, we can watch three tombstones. These are the only ones to have escaped destruction, though we know that it was the last resting place of 11 Grand Masters. Near the enlarged church, a quadrilateral tower was built. It served as a belfry and a point of vantage. The six stories raised over the walls of the high castle made the tower become a characteristic element in the skyline of the castle of Malbork. Still more complete reconstruction was carried out in the castle approaches, which were turned into the middle castle. The eastern part was filled with a long building designed for guests of the order, the knights arriving to take part in the crusades against Lithuania and Samogitia. The northern wing was divided into two parts by the gate tower. Here was the main entrance to the castle. Behind the decorative gable in the western part of the wing, there was an infirmary, or rather home for the aged and disabled lay brethren. The magnificent architecture of the palace of the Grand Masters makes us realize that we're in front of the most presentable part of the castle in Malbork. In the middle of the 14th century, when the palace was under construction, the Grand Masters were taking over the functions of dukes. They were becoming sovereign rulers. Fine architecture was to emphasize the splendor of their court and status. Therefore, the fortified state gave way to dignity a little. A low vestibule and a high one led to the most presentable rooms of the palace. The high vestibule led to the summer refectory. The hall, lit up with dozens of windows, was admitted to be one of the most magnificent Gothic interiors. It was the place of audiences granted by the Grand Masters. Close by is the winter refectory. The fine palm vault is resting on one slender column. There is one more famous room next to the palace. This is the Grand Refectory. The knights who helped the lay brethren with their fight against the pagans used to be received in here. Unfortunately, the process of slow foundation settlement that has been going on for hundreds of years brings about cracks in the walls and vaults of this part of the castle. The cracks are growing larger, which is more and more threatening. That is why we can show this beautiful place only on photographs. Naturally, the presentable interiors are merely a part of the complex in Malbork. After all, the state of the Teutonic Order was a perfectly organized body. For instance, the vast attics of the middle castle served as granaries. There functioned a mint in the castle of Marlborough as well. However, its own money, the assistance of foreign knights, or the imposing fortifications, Marlborough could not protect the state of the order from the decline, as its formula was becoming outdated. Marlborough kept on being an impregnable fortress. Yet, in 1457, its garrison opened the gates themselves. Because of the insolvency of the order, the hired troops simply sold the castle to the Polish king. That way, the first period in the history of Marlborough came to an end. On the 8th of June 1457, the gates of Marlborough opened for the triumphant entrance of the Polish king Kazimierz Jagiellon. The day before, the Grand Master Ludwig von Erlichhausen left in a hurry. The castle changed its owners, but that did not bring any significant changes. Some elements in the present arrangement of the interiors, such as furniture or tapestries, remind that Marlborough used to be one of the royal residences, of not much importance though. The fireplaces or armorial cartouches in the former palace of the Grand Masters prove that the Polish kings used to stay here occasionally. For some length of time, even a mint functioned here. Normally, however, Marlborough was just the seat of the starost of the district. Here are the starost's portraits from the castle museum. In the 16th and 17th centuries, the castle garrison was composed of about 200 men, and the castle was used as a military base. In the eastern wing of the middle castle, the Maritime Commission, that is, the administration of the Polish Navy, had its seat. Marlborough was gradually losing its military importance as the line of the main threats to the Polish state shifted towards the east and the south. After the Swedish wars in the 17th century, which brought a lot of destruction to the castle, it simply began to fall into decay. In 1772, the first partition of Poland took place. A part of the Polish lands was obtained by Prussia. Thus, the 300-year period of Marlborough under Polish rule ends. Almost immediately, the Prussian authorities proceeded to adapt the castle for barracks and storage warehouses. By the drawings and photographs from the 19th century, we can estimate the scale of the transformations. Rows of new rectangular windows were hewn in the walls of the high castle in order to light up the warehouses. Besides, the old windows were blinded and the roofs lowered. Almost all the Gothic vaults in the interiors were demolished and replaced with wooden ceilings. The cloisters were walled up and the facades were plastered. The halls in the palace of the Grand Masters were separated with ceilings and partition walls, changing them into a cotton spinning mill and flats for weavers. In the Grand Refectory, a drill room for the troops was made, which brought about its devastation. Besides, dwelling houses were built closer and closer to the castle, and their walls leaned on the defensive walls. The line of the castle fortifications became completely illegible. Finally, it was decided to pull the castle down. Here are the drawings that saved the castle in Marlborough. The publication of the drawings in 1799 by some young artists of Berlin drew the attention of the public opinion to the castle. The moment was appropriate, as Romanticism had brought fascination with the Middle Ages and the architecture of that time. The result was that in 1804, the edict by the King of Prussia, Frederick William III, established grounds for the protection and the rebuilding of the castle. Thereby, Malbork became one of the first monuments of history in Europe, which was comprised by protection. The restoration works were focused on the middle castle. As regards the palace of the Grand Masters, it was sufficient to remove the Prussian adaptations in order to uncover the original medieval interiors. Karl Friedrich Schinkel himself, one of the most famous architects of that epoch, was involved in the preservation works. The floors in the summer refectory, which were designed by him, have been preserved to this day. As a result of the works carried out, the renovated middle castle was made accessible to visitors as early as the 40s of the 19th century. The second stage of the castle restoration commenced in the 80s. At that time, the works started to be systematically recorded, and more than 2,000 photographs were to be found in the succeeding books called Baujahrs. They illustrate the 40 years of preservation works, which between 1882 and 1920 were supervised by Konrad Steinbrecht. It was him who reconstructed the Malbork of the Middle Ages. The works were started in the High Castle. Among other things, Steinbrecht established the original heights of the roofs and restored them. Then he reconstructed the cloisters. He started to conserve the church and the chapel situated underneath. The archaeological examinations allowed the reconstruction of many architectural details. At times, the medieval details returned to their place, and at times, Steinbrecht designed new elements. The preservation works were carried out by more than 50 craftsmen of various specialties. They were reconstructing the doors, furniture, and wall paintings. In solicitude about historicity and veracity, former patterns and materials were used. It must be said, however, that the force of works carried out for a few decades resulted not only from the historic values of Malbork. The preserved photographs confirm numerous inspections made by the successive rulers from the House of Hohenzollern. For Malbork was a symbol of the traditions to which they wanted to keep in Prussia. The young German state had to fan the nationalist feelings by creating symbols due to them. When Hitler attained power, Malbork became a symbol of the expansive Eastern policy in a still more distinct way. In the Grand Refectory, oath-taking ceremonies were held by soldiers leaving for the Eastern Front. All that took place in the castle, which after 40 years of Steinbrecht's and his successors' work had been brought to its medieval shape and splendor. In those days, no one could foresee that the most tragic destruction in the 700 years history of the castle was still to come. In early 1945, after a long bombardment of the castle turned into a fortress, it fell to ruin. Primarily, the eastern side of the high and middle castle was destroyed seriously. Only a huge gap was left after the church and the chapel in the high castle. The buildings in the castle approaches were almost completely destroyed as well. It was assessed that 50% of the whole castle complex had been destroyed. After the war, the removal of thousands of cubic meters of rubble was started, but it was not obvious at all that the castle would be rebuilt. The war and the occupation caused Poles to immediately associate Malbork with the Nazi aggression. There even appeared opinions that the castle should be demolished. Fortunately, the idea was given up and the rebuilding was started. The turning point was 1961, when the Castle Museum was set up. Intensive works were taken up in the sphere of building and preservation. In the 1970s, the rebuilding of the high and middle castle was completed. However, within such a huge structure, preservation experts will always have something to do. Besides, some problems have never been solved yet. In spite of the fact that international companies have been engaged, the works are still going on and tourists are not allowed to see the Grand Refectory. Generally, however, thanks to the systematic works of conservators, the castle and its interiors are more and more attractive for tourists. Here are the decorations on the vaults of the low vestibule, reconstructed from the medieval traces. And these are the other rooms in the Palace of the Grand Masters, where the polychromy restoration was finished not long ago. In many cases, the works of German conservators are being continued. Here, for example, the young specialists are uncovering the wall paintings made before the war. They will be preserved, and in this way, the German conservators' work will become a monument as well. Therefore, we can see that the castle is a fuller and fuller document of the past, the same as above. We are saying goodbye to Malbork, about which now we can say that it arose three times. Built by the order, brought to splendor for the second time by the German conservators, for the third time it was restored by Poles. This way, it ceases to be a symbol of our difficult past and becomes our common heritage.